Hi, I'm Jesper Pedersen from KDAB. You're watching Programming with Qt and QML. We're almost done with the section on animation. Now we're going to see state and transitions, and it doesn't entirely fit into animations, but still, I'll show you why. I got a state machine here. Well, it lacks the machine part of a state machine, but I got a bunch of states and transitions between those states. It's your typical stoplight here, going from red to red-yellow, over to green, back to yellow, and back to red. And that's a full circle. My application is set up like this. I got three rectangles here, the red, the yellow, and the green rectangle. They each have a position and a width and a height, and a radius. Yeah, you can go back and tell your mom. A circle is just a special case of a rectangle where the corners are really, really round. That's what we see here. That's my rectangles that have turned into a bunch of circles. Now, this is just setting up of these. Specially notice the lag of a line 9.5, the lag of a line 15.5, and the lag of a line 21.5, each of them saying color colon. Of course, we don't specify that in the default setup. The colors are set up, and over here you can see now the traffic light is actually running. The colors are set up using a number of states. Here's my stop state, here's my waiting state, and I'll bet you there are two other states for the go state and the slowdown state. And each of those states we are specifying property changes. The target are red light, yellow light, and green light, red, yellow, and green light. And in this stop state, I want my red light to be red, my yellow and green light, each of them to be gray. Let's see the code in action. Again, my rectangles that are set up here, my outer rectangle that is black. Here are my four states now. I got a state property down here that tells me what is my current state. And I got a timer that tells me that it should run for 1,000 seconds infinitely, because repeat colon true, it should start running right away. And every time it goes off, it should figure out what is the next index here. It's just a bit of JavaScript magic to figure out what is going to be my next state, and I'm going to update parent.state to that state. Yes, I know. I've been asking a lot of you. First of all, I've been asking you to not quit this series just because of my terrible jokes. And now I'm going to ask you for a leap of faith in here. Please do believe me that this state stuff is actually a better way of programming your QML. Let me just rewrite this application here without the state stuff, and you'll see that I am totally full of beep, 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 beep. Yes, it will not look better in this very simple example, but hopefully when I rewrite it, you'll see that, okay, there are values to the more expressive states and transitions that we do here. Rewriting goes like this. First of all, I need to throw away this states here so that you actually can see that it works. Then it goes up here. So color of this rectangle here should be, well, that depends, of course, which state I'm in. So it will go state equal to, well, each element has a state property. It's something that comes from the item element. So I better go to, or let's be slightly more expressive. Just imagine that we one day wanted to extend this here. So id colon root. Color root dot state equal to, and let me just scroll down here, stop state. If I'm in stop state, then it should be red. Otherwise should be, or is it light gray? Let's just copy that line because we're gonna have that three times. Stop state, wait state, drive state, and yellow, green. Let's run it. Red, yellow, green, something, red, Oh yeah, of course. There was this slow state. That when I go to the slow state, then it's my yellow that should root.state. There we are. So red, yellow, green, yellow, red. Oh wait, it shouldn't be, it should be red, yellow in that state. So it should red also when I'm in the wait state. I hope at this point in the video you have found your button for speeding up, because I am dragging time here just to make a point. And my point is that you can see the code is getting uglier and uglier. And further on, it's getting, well, finally I got it right. But just imagine that I wanted, I had a specification from my customer that said that this one, my rectangle here should have a, the radius of this particular one should be 25 when it was in the yellow, when it was yellow. Otherwise, it should be 50. Yeah, I don't know who would want a traffic light looking like this, but you get the idea. Now I cut and pasted this code here and something else and something else. And before you know it, my code that set up what my user interface looks like has all of these if whatever, could be either full-blown if statements, or it could be these ternary question mark colon statement with sub question mark colons and sub question mark colons, and it would be completely unreadable. With a number of states instead, I specify for each of my states. I can sit there and say, okay, this state has these properties that I need to update. In this particular state, what should each of them look like? I want to add another property. Well, I'll just go and add one line to each of my states and then ponder for each of those. And I would know, hey, I actually did remember them all. So I hope the leap of faith that I asked you for isn't that enormously gigantic, like walking on the moon leap of faith. I hope that you will give it a shot and try it in your own applications. There is two things that can trip you over when you start using states and transition states as we see here. The first one is the state property. If you do not specify anything, it's a string. Can you guess what the value is going to be? Yes, of course, it's going to magically be go state. No, it's going to be an empty string. So do remember to specify the initial state. And the same thing is that if you do not specify a property in one of your property changes, then that particular property will restore to the value that it had when you set up the element with that property. I'll show you both examples here in this little example here. So the first one, my state colon, I did not specify a state. State colon, I did not specify one of these, so it ended up looking exactly like this. And when my QML kicks in, it'll go states. Oh, awesome. So it's one of those things with states in it. Let me see, is it empty strings that equal to state A? No. Empty strings that equal to state B? No. Empty strings that equal to state C? No. Okay. Then it's not one of these states, so I'm not going to update X, Y, and color. They will be whatever they were when I specified it. So if you look at my example again here, light blue, yes, that's light blue. Y100, yes, it's that position Y100. Fortunately, when I wrote the mouse area that transitioned me through the states, I thought of this empty state, because you can see A to B, B to C, C to A, and then the empty thing also to A. Otherwise, I might even have had a problem bootstrapping the whole thing. But empty thing to A, to B, to C, to A, to B. And now let's see the C. down here, state C, I did not specify a Y. I did so in all of the others. The question is, what value will Y have? Will it be unchanged? Will it revert back to the state before I entered into state B? No, none of the above. It will actually revert to the value that I specified whenever I set up my element. So up here it says rectangle y colon 100, and that's the value. So with that, two common problems are solved for you. Remember, one, to create and or set the value, the property state, to the initial state. Two, update all of your properties in all of your states. Of course, if you do that, then you will see there's this block of 8 property changes in each of my states. And that makes it also easier for you to validate that you thought about each of the property and each of the states that you are transitioning through. There are two ways you can work with states. Way number one is that you give each of your state a name. The second way of doing it is that you specify a when. So let's see this example here. In this example, I only have two states to jump between. I have the state of that there is text in here, and the state when there's no text in there. When there's no text in there, my button should be grayed out. When there's text in there, it shouldn't be grayed out. That's the only two states. I got my two states down here, and they do not have a name written to them. I could have given them a name, but they don't. It's simply a when colon and then an expression that means that whenever this expression is true, then this state is the one that is the active state. And of course, they should be mutable. Only one of them should be evaluating to true at a given time. That's states. You have a number of states in your application. And now we come to the second part of a state machine. Well, there's three parts to the state machine. There's the machine part. Well, you need to run that yourself. We saw that with the mouse area that I clicked and I transitioned through the different states. Then there's the state part, and we've seen that. We set them up, and for each of the state, we specify our property changes for that particular state. And the last part is the transition. So have a number of states, and you can go from one state to the next state. And when you do so, you can have an animation running. Hey, that's why this is in the animation section. Yes, I know. I needed it in one place, right? Can you forgive me? Thank you. Here is what it looks like. And let's just jump right to the code. And let's look at what it does over here. You see the difference, right? There's a huge difference from the previous one, namely that it's every time I change light, it takes 100 milliseconds to dim in or dim out. I'll bet you if you asked your mom-in-law or your grandma, whoever, well, granddad, I'm not, he or she would tell you, yes, the one that dims in or out looks much better than the other one, simply because that's their expectation of nature, that nothing happens instantly. It's just, however, a short time still there is a dim in and dim out. I'll bet you, I'll challenge you next time you're sitting there in your car in front of a stoplight, observe it. Let's see the code. Rectangle, rectangle, rectangle. That's my three circles. Here are my four states as set up before. My timer, we've seen that before too. And now here are my transitions from stop state to wait state. I got a property animation happening. The target is the red light and the yellow light. The property that I want to animate is color, and I want to do that for 100 milliseconds. Yeah, I guess it should have been a color animation, but let that be. If I go from wait state to drive state, blah, blah, blah. If I go from drive to stop or to slow, blah, blah, blah. If I go from slow to stop, blah, blah, blah. Yeah, I'm just testing you to see how far you're willing to go. Next, I have a bridge for sale. I'm telling you, I am not kidding you. I'm showing you the full power of the transitions here. You can, for each and single transition, you can specify how should things happen. Seldomly you need that much power. And I'm glad to show you the next example here, because the next example has what we call a wildcard transition. And this is now the complete code for the transition. When you go from any state to any state, then red light, the yellow light, and the green light should animate the color for 100 milliseconds. But in the previous one we had over here, you had the full power. If you do not need the full power, then you can use the wildcard up here. And even the wildcard here is, if you do not specify from colon and to colon, you can take line number 3 and throw that out, and your transitions are down to these 7 lines of code. Sometimes you do have different transitions for a different part of your state hierarchy, but for any, but you can go forth and back between two states. And when you do that, you want the same transition. And in that case, we have this reversible property that we can set on the transition. So I explicitly want to go from the with text to the without text in this particular setup. And it's both directions, I should animate the opacity of my clear button for a second. So see how it goes away. Yeah, that's it. That was it. We saw states. We saw the state machine. That's you. We saw the transitions where you can run the animation for your, for how you go from one state to the other. And this is where you'll say, but wait, Jesper, I want a real state machine. You know, the one that, like one of those commercial one with a state drawing editor and whatnot. Well, that might be for another episode. Go and look at the QML, or at the C++, sorry, the C++ layer. There we do have real state machines for running complex state diagrams. We also have a Q-declarative state machine where you set up your states on the QML level. It's not as bad as doing business logic in QML, because most of what that QML state machine will do for you is then reach into C++. But that is possibly for another episode. This concludes this whole module. In the next module, I'm gonna blow your mind right away. We're gonna see the repeater element. We're gonna see list view. We're gonna see how we can customize the list view. We're gonna see the grid view with the path view and lots of other interesting things. It might not have come out at the time you watch this movie, so please do subscribe to our channels. And even if it comes out and you can run right and see it right away, well, please do subscribe nevertheless, because we plan on putting out material on our KDAB channel here for years and years to come, I hope. Until then, have a great day.